just the lies. But nothing's sweeter than the day we find forgiveness, forgiveness. And we all stumble and we fall. Rage is burning, the heat of it all. Nothing's sweeter than the day, sweeter than the day we call. No matter how lost you are, we all need forgiveness. No matter how hurt you are, we all need forgiveness. No matter how wrong you are, you're not that far, you're not too far. No matter who you are, you're not too far, you're not too far.
Oh, it's 4 o'clock. Let's stop.
Ndo chekichin ekeleno.
I bet it's not.
Ndo chekichin ekeleno.
I bet it's me.
Keki mere.
Good to see you.
Nde wonde begi kweni.
Nde shiboma.
Work.
As Munde Begiquen, don't mind IJ. Don't forget about IJ. And then the Begiquen.
Sorry, all that you can say.
Yes, I can say sorry.
Words don't come easily. Like sorry, forgive me. It's all that you can say. You don't.
Thank you, everyone. Welcome to Oche Kitchen this evening. Thanks for joining us. And I'll introduce our guest host today. We have Reverend Father Emmanuel Ihemedu. Father, thank you very much for joining us. Ibali, I love you.
Thank you.
Ihemedu, he didn't correct you. He corrected me.
Okay.
Okay. And the second guest, Akita. Wapa.
He's having technical issues. He's here, but he's having audio issues, so...
Okay.
Audio, let him click his phone now.
We will introduce him as soon as he joins us again. And for today's show, we're talking about forgiveness. Forgiveness, forgiveness. Sorry. Very simple word, but very difficult to say. And we'll start with, we've got actually, let me introduce the house host, Aije Ndoku.
Hi, everybody. Thanks for joining us.
Oje Gweke.
Oje, okay.
Hi.
Hello.
And me, if you mama, Mbadinuju. And make a no, welcome.
There you
are. And let's sit down and enjoy the evening. Oje, over to you.
Okay. So over time, people have hurt each other. And they continue to hurt one another. From the Bible, we have cases and stories of betrayals at different levels. And I used to wonder how gracious Joseph was to have forgiven his brothers. It still happens in the present world where injustice abounds, like the cases of police brutality and the rape victims, especially when they are minors. How do you even begin to forgive these things? Are these unforgivable sins? Which brings us to our first question. How do you define forgiveness? So it's over to you, Father Emmanuel.
Good afternoon or good evening, wherever you you may be. My name is Father Emmanuel, and I want to assume that everybody speaks Igbo, right?
Yeah, but yeah. I have we have Jamaicans here. We have people that don't speak.
So I live here in Connecticut. I'm a little bit about myself. I'm a priest and I've been ordained for 14 years. I also teach at the University of St. Joseph in the counseling department. I have a background, PhD in counseling psych. So that's my day job, so to speak. But my full-time job is being a priest. So when we talk about forgiveness, forgiveness is actually the process of the action of forgiving someone or being forgiven. The way I look at it is being able to let go of anger that people have prompted in us as a result of a breach of legitimate expectation, a breach of trust, a breach of love. And it can also, that letting go can take a long period of time. It doesn't have to happen overnight. So the process of letting go the hurts, letting go the anger, yes, that people have prompted upon us. So that's the way I would define forgiveness. Okay.
So since our psychologist is having issues connecting, I would like to throw it open to our viewers. Does anyone have anything to say as a follow-up of what he has just explained? What do you understand forgiveness to be? Does anybody have anything to say, or do we go ahead to the second question?
Can I say something?
Yes.
Forgiveness, I see as letting off that weight.
Mm-hmm.
Dropping that heavy load. That's just what forgiveness means to me. Dropping it. Yeah. So that's my simple take on it.
It is, it's the same, it's along the same line. Like when you let go the grudge, the resentment, the anger that you feel as a result of someone, and the person hurt you, and there is a crack on the wall of trust, right? And you have that heaviness that you carry because you trusted this person, you love them, and you could never imagine that they would ever hurt you that much. And you have that, being able to let go of that anger, being able to let go of that resentment, being able to let go of that grudge that you have, the process of doing that, even though it may take a while, it's actually, that's the way I see forgiveness. Okay.
So Father, I have something. What if you're angry at God?
Yes.
Because I know I am.
Mm-hmm.
I was just watching a show before this Ocho Kitchen program, and something clicked. I was watching a series called Dead to Me, right? Mm-hmm. A guy died, and it's a Jewish guy. So they went for the funeral. It was a Jewish funeral. So one of the guests, she's Christian, so she asked the rabbi, and she said, "That was a beautiful prayer. What does it mean?" The rabbi said, "Oh, we are giving thanks to God. Like in everything, we have to give thanks, right?" And the girl was like, "How can you forgive God that took away somebody you love?" You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
And the rabbi said, "You have to forgive God for you to be forgiven." And I know for a long time, everybody who knows me knows I have a child with disability. For a long time, I was so angry because I couldn't understand how, you know what I mean? I couldn't understand it. Why would God allow this to happen? And you know what I mean? So I don't even go to church. Anybody who knows me knows I don't go to church. So I say I am like, not that I don't believe in God or anything, I do, but I know I am angry. So for somebody like me, what can you tell me apart from everything is God's plan?
Now, first of all, I want to acknowledge the emotion that you feel, the anger. You have to understand that being angry is not sinful. Anger is, we are created to, it's one of the emotions that God created us with.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that you are angry. We have no control over being angry, but we have control how we express the anger. So sometimes people confuse the emotion of anger. And if you express anger, people think that you are. And I said, no. If you read, I believe, Ephesians chapter 4, verse 26, St. Paul says, be angry, but do not sin. Uh-huh. Be angry, but do not sin. So being angry is part of our nature. Jesus was angry himself. We know that in Mark chapter 3, verse 5. God gave us that emotion to protect family, to protect our reputation. So that is part of who we are. Now, how we express it is a different thing. Okay. That's where the sin comes. But the feeling, the emotion of anger is, we are wired that way. Okay. It's normal. Anger can be good. Anger can be be positive and negative.
Okay. If I might say something briefly, because there's a comment from Benson on Zoom. I'm going to read it. But first of all, I would like to say something about how you feel, IJ. You know that, like you said, you were asking and you were angry that God should let this happen. Yes, I agree. He lets things happen, but most times he doesn't do them. Okay? And sometimes there are reasons why he allows these things to happen. It's like when you're watching a child trying to put his hand in fire. If eventually that child, you can actually say, can you move out from the lamp? And he continues. That child definitely gets burnt, okay? But that doesn't mean that you as an adult that was sitting down there, that you made that fire burn her. So sometimes too, when we consider the fact that there's another being, which is Satan, we will start to understand that it's not everything that happens to us that God has a hand in. So I'm going to read what Benson said. Benson said, psychologists generally define forgiveness as a conscious, deliberate decision to release feelings of resentment or vengeance towards a person or group who has harmed you, regardless of whether they actually deserve your forgiveness. Forgiveness does not mean forgetting, nor does it mean condoning or excusing offenses.
Yes.
Okay, thank you, Benson. Because we needed that angle. You know, we had a psychologist that was meant to be here with us, but he's having technical issues.
I can see him. Hello, Anayo.
Is he here now?
Yeah, he's on. Anayo, can you hear us?
No, he's...
He left a message here. He says he can't get the volume on.
Yeah. So... Well, he's right to say that forgiveness does not mean forgetting.
So we're going to get to that point. Okay. You know, he just defined forgiveness because the first question was, how do you define forgiveness? So he gave the psychological meaning. So without wasting much time, we're going to go to question number two. Sure. What is the relationship between love and forgiveness?
From the theological perspective, we have to understand that without love, you would have no forgiveness, right? The Bible says in John chapter 3, verse 16, that God so loved the world that he sent his only son, that anyone who believes in him will not perish, but will have eternal life. I mean, think about this. So the forgiveness is the act. Love is the reason behind the act. Why did he die on the cross? Out of love, you know? John chapter 15, verse 13 says, greater love than this no one has to lay down one's life for one's friends. So they are related because what's the primary reason why Jesus came? I mean, so let's take it that in Genesis, you know, after the sins of Adam and Eve, there was an executive order from heaven, you know, if you want to use that. Executive order that's banning, yes, banning any entrance. Right? So, but God's love moved him, prompted him to send his only son. And it is because of that love that he gave his life for us. That's why scripture says that we were still sinners when he died for us. So love is the reason, the fundamental reason for the act of forgiveness. You know?
Okay. So does anyone have anything to say?
Your interpersonal relationships with your loved ones. Right. The reason why you go ahead to forgive them is because of your love for them.
Mm-hmm. Very true.
I did it because I love him. I did it because I love her. Love is always the reason behind, you know.
Sometimes you don't even need to explain. We just know. That love.
Yeah, OJ, Pamela wants to say something.
Okay, Pamela, please go ahead. Is she muted?
I don't even think she has volume. I can't even unmute her.
Okay. Chi, do you have anything?
Pamela, can you hear us? Okay, go ahead.
No, Father Emmanuel has said it all, like, why love and the forgiveness, yes.
Okay. So I would like to go to the third question. Why is forgiveness important, and why should I forgive a person who has hurt me?
Exactly.
Okay, well, my assumption is that we are Christians, and that's where I'm coming from. And every now and then I may, you know, speak from the counseling and psychological background. But why is forgiveness important? Because for those of us who call ourselves Christians, unforgiveness is not an option. You know, because as long as we hold on to the hurts, and hold on to unforgiveness, we wouldn't be able to hold on to God. Our unforgiveness hinges on our ability to forgive others. If you read, I believe, Matthew chapter 6, verse 12, forgive us as we forgive others. Mm-hmm. If you read the Lord's Prayer that we say every day, every time,
yeah.
Forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those. And I believe in Matthew 6, 14 to 15, it says, if you forgive others, God will forgive you. You have to forgive for you to be forgiven. You know, that's where it becomes tough. So, yes. And why should I forgive the person who hurt me? Often, you know, forgiveness does not have to be a two-way traffic. It can be a one-way traffic. Reconciliation is a two-way traffic. I need a sincere apology from the person who hurt me in order for me to forgive and reconcile with them. But forgiveness can just be a one-way traffic. You know, think about sometimes people have hurt you without even knowing that they have hurt you, and they moved on. And you're carrying the grudge, the resentment. So I would forgive in order to amend my relationship with the Lord, and at the same time, for my own well-being. Because unforgiveness and bearing grudges can take a toll on your physical and psychological health. And studies have shown that.
Okay. Thank you. Binka, you have something to say?
Okay. For me, I tell people to forgive. I forgive people because it's like a bondage. When you've not forgiven someone, you are holding the person on captive and you're holding yourself too. But when you release the person, you see yourself start healing of that hurt and start feeling better. So it's like what the Igbos say, you bring it down. So you just forgive just to release your heart of that hurt. So to me, it's not a two-way traffic for me. I don't care if you're apologizing or not. But in my heart, I have to forgive you and let go so that I'll be free of that, unless I'll keep thinking about it.
Okay. So, Binta, I have a question for you. Assuming I piss you off, right? And you're hot about it. And you tell me that I pissed you off. And I say, I don't care. Go to hell. You still forgive me?
Yeah, you know, the process of even telling you is actually the process of healing. Because for me to take that bold step to let you know is that I want to let it go. So my telling you doesn't mean that I want a special apology. So it's just for me to let it go. For you to also know, be conscious, because word is like a seed. Once I have mentioned it to you, it has been planted. It's in your subconscious somewhere that actually you heard this person. Right. So you won't do that to anybody.
If I may interject a little bit, I agree. That said, I also want to be careful not to enable bad behavior. You know, so for example, I do not want to enable somebody who hurt me and I have made it known to them, but they are bold in their error. They are bold, you know, in their error. While I may forgive them just to release the negative emotions, at the same time, I have to set boundaries. It does not mean that I have to put myself in a position where that individual who is hurting me will keep on hurting me over and over again. I will not do that. That
Amen.
Is not Christian.
Amen to that.
That is not Christian. Yes.
That's I what I believe. That. Exactly. I believe that. I believe that.
Exactly.
Okay.
Exactly.
Does and also,
I think Choma Anyanwu wants to say something.
Okay.
Yeah. In terms of what you just asked, my other sister, that if somebody hurt her and she reached out to the person and the person add more fuel into the whole fire, is she still going to forgive the person? My own take is, it depends on who the person is and the type of character the person possess. If you hurt me, and I know you're the kind of person, if I reach out to you, you'll be reasonable enough to understand that you've hurt me and we can talk about it, then I can reach out. But in terms of reaching out to you, and I know you're going to add more injury, because I don't understand how, if you're hurting and somebody hurts you more, I don't think it's going to be so easy for you to start thinking about forgiving. That's like doubling the problem right there. So what I do, I either reach out to you if I know you're going to be reasonable enough to be able to understand that it hurt me, because some people, they don't even care. So if you understand some people that don't care, you should know your friends or people around you. You don't have to reach out to that person. You don't want to hurt yourself more, because it's going to keep being in your head. And again, forgiveness is very, very key, because I don't think anybody deserves to rent in my head for free, because I think we have a lot of things to think about. We have where we're going. You need to be focused, right? So if you have all these things bottled up in your head, you're not going to release yourself. So I believe in forgiving. I can forgive you from a distance. I don't have to come so close or reach out to you. And again, forgive you in such a way that at least I'll be able to move on, have my sanity, have my good relationship with God, and I'll be able to think straight and be happy, because happiness is free. The world is so short that you don't want to have somebody hurting you over and over again. So think about it. If you know somebody who keeps hurting you, just stay away. Forgive them from afar and just, you know, keep your sanity.
All right.
Okay. Thank you. So we're going to go to the number four question. But right after this question, before I let you say something, Emmanuel, I'm going to say something myself. So the question is, why do people not forgive? Okay, that's question number four. Why do people not forgive? I'm going to tell you what happened to a friend of mine exactly 1 year ago. His wife went to Lagos on the job, and someone went to her hotel room the day she was meant to come back to Abuja and killed her.
Oh!
The guy stabbed her to death. Yes. Okay. So for me, I consider that unforgivable.
Amen.
Right now, me.
But I'm sorry, but amen to that.
I feel so bad. Do you understand that if that guy would stand in front of me, and yet I'm not the husband? So that brings me to this question.
I have a question for you.
I used to think that there's nothing anybody would do.
Bam, hold on.
I used to think that there's nothing anybody would do that is unforgivable. But I consider this one unforgivable. You understand? So that is why the number four question is, why do people forgive?
OJ, please, this story now, the person that shot her, do they know her?
Not even them. Not shot, he stabbed her several times.
Okay, they know the person.
He has been arrested.
No, why I'm asking is because when we're saying we can't forgive, if it's somebody that you know, then I can say yes. But if somebody you don't know, I'll tell myself, God, take control. So now, what are you asking, if it's somebody you know or somebody you don't know?
Somebody I know was killed. I don't know.
What I'm saying, when somebody you know hurts you like that, that's what I'm asking, because this question is, I don't know. It depends on which angle you're coming from.
Can you guys hold on? Anayo, can you hear us?
Yes, I can hear you now. Thank you very much.
Our second panel guy is here, Dr. Anayo Uhiara. Okay, welcome. All right, Father, can you answer then? Or do you go through it to Anayo?
Father, sorry, before you go on to that, can we just take a commercial? Then we'll carry on, please. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you very much. Hello?
Natura, Natura, Natura International, shipping, clearing with a difference. Natura ship to all part of the world. Part of our services are work on your behalf in searching and buying equipment, truck, cars, machinery, until they get to their final destination. Global freight forwarding, air freight and cargo, warehousing, consolidation, construction of oil and gas equipment, and display cars and trucks for sale at a competitive prices. Natura, Natura International.
Thank you very much for your patience, and thanks to Natura for constantly supporting us. Oje, our father.
Yes.
Take your question.
So the question is, why do people not forgive?
Yes.
Before I say that, let me quickly respond to OJ's, and I can understand how you feel. Well, my question is, are we obligated to forgive those who do not want us to forgive them? Are we obligated to forgive those who do not want us to forgive them? I say no. We have no obligation to forgive anyone. I'm not saying we shouldn't, I said, but we do not have the obligation. If you read Luke's Gospel, chapter 17, from verse 3 to 4, it says, if your brother sins, rebuke him. If he repents, forgive him. If your brother sins, rebuke him.
Now I feel better.
If he repents,
yeah,
forgive him. Now,
yeah.
If he repents, Jesus says, but it doesn't say regardless of whether he does or does not. It says if he repents, forgive him. So if someone is not sorry and they are bold in hurting us, I don't have the obligation to forgive him. I can forgive him or her just because of my relationship with the Lord, as I said before. But I do not have the, it's not like I am required to forgive them. Now, going to the fourth question, why do people not forgive? You know, there are many reasons. It hurts when people you trust so much betray your trust, betray your hope, betray your love. Trust minimizes anxiety in a relationship. And when trust is gone, it's hard. There's always a crack. I mean, the way I look at it is, it's like a wound you have, right?
Yes.
And once that wound is gone, it leaves a scar. Whenever you see the scar, it reminds you of what happened. So often, that gets in the way and people find it difficult to forgive. Another reason is because people think that when they forgive, they have let the person off the hook. If I forgive him, if I forgive her, they got out easy. We see it as an act of injustice. There is something that happens to us in our mind that we think deep down within us that we are in control when we hold on to unforgiveness. The other reason I believe is, as humans, every now and then we make God our images. For example, we have these categories of what is forgivable and what is not forgivable. And we raise the bar so high for ourselves. And so when a loved one commits any of those or does anything that is within the category that I have created for myself, that I believe they're unforgivable, then it's hard for me to forgive. Even myself, when I do any of those things that I consider unforgivable, guess what? I'm disillusioned. I project my sense of unforgiveness and unworthiness onto God. When in reality, I'm the one who set the bar so high. When in reality, I'm the one who failed myself. So every now and then we have these categories. This is forgivable, this is unforgivable. And if anybody does anything that is in that category that is unforgivable, according to my own expectations, it's hard for me to let go. So those are some of the reasons, and I believe that you can come up with so many others why people find it tough to forgive. But trust minimizes anxiety.
The ability to forgive.
Yes, once that trust is gone, it's kind of tough. And don't get me wrong, when that trust is gone, sometimes those of us, especially if you are the perpetrator, and we say, I'm sorry, and we want the person to just flip, you know, and start feeling normal again, you can't do that. You can't. We have to remember that prudence requires that this person no longer treat us the way they were treating us when we betrayed, when we did not betray their trust. We have to give them some time. We have to earn that trust again. You can't just say, you did all of that and you come to me and you say, you're sorry. And then you expect me to just do flip right away. My emotions.
So there's no speedway to the forgiveness highway, on the forgiveness highway. There's no speed limit. There isn't. It could take me 1 mile per hour.
That's all right. As long as you begin the process, that's okay.
All right. You
know, yes. Okay.
So, Father, I would like to thank you for being very, very realistic, you know, because a lot of people live in the ideal world. They don't live in the realistic world. But you are being realistic by saying that there are even things, because we are all human beings at the end of the day. And like I always say, I am actually Chineke, you know, I'm Christ's disciple, but I'm not Christ. So it would naturally take me time. And being the kind of person that I am, I know that there are things that it's one step at a time. You can't just, I don't believe in, you know, flipping the lights. My emotions are not like light switches. You put it off, you put it on. So if I'm going to go through something, allow me to process it, to go through it. And that's the only way I can have a closure. So when somebody expects that, oh, because the person has begged for forgiveness, you should just forgive. It doesn't work that way.
You can also tell the individual, listen, I don't work that way. I'm not like a switch light. It's going to take me a little time. I am working on it. All right.
Exactly.
Because to forgive and to forget means to throw away anger and wisdom at the same time.
Oh,
forgiveness is foolishness.
Richard.
You can't throw away the wisdom's reason. You have to set some boundaries. The people have to show in their action that
or press the delete button.
They have to earn it. You can't just put yourself. You know, a lot of our women have suffered from, you know, battered women syndrome as a result of misinterpretation of that particular gospel that says when somebody beats you on one cheek, you turn the other way. No. No, you cannot put yourself in that kind of position because you are. I don't think that's what God wants for. I'd rather have a divorced sister than to have one who is battered and bruised or even dead because of marriage.
Thank you.
No.
Okay, so would Anayo want to say something? Anayo, do you have anything to contribute to this question? Why do people not forgive? As a psychologist, what do you say?
I think he's out again.
Okay.
I think he's out again. Yeah. Okay, go ahead.
Okay, so that takes us to question number 5. How does forgiveness impact your health?
Oh my God. Okay.
I think Pamela's hand is up too. Yeah. Father, go ahead.
You want me to talk? I thought somebody's hand was up. I can.
Okay, Pamela, yeah. Okay. Yes. Pamela,
go ahead.
Pamela, can you unmute your phone? Unmute. I'm pressing mute and you're pressing at the same time. Unmute yourself. Okay, go ahead.
Okay, no, Father, go ahead. My question was for number 4, but somebody else has asked the question that I wanted to ask. I just wanted to know if the lady that was killed, the person that killed her, do they know the person? Was it a family member or was it a close friend or a distant friend? That was what I wanted to know.
Okay, thank you. Well, this question, number 5 question is also in line with number 12 question that says, what are the effects of bearing grudges over time? I think they have a little bit of a relationship. Well, carrying unforgiveness can take a toll on your physical health. You know, it can also take a toll on your emotional health. I mean, studies have shown that people who carry grudges and people who tend to be unforgiving, they tend to experience stronger negative emotions. And they have more stress, you know, physiological stress responses. Whereas people who forgive, right, who don't carry grudges and they tend to experience great positive emotion, greater perceived control, less potent negative emotion and stress in the short time. So in other words, even if you don't want to do it for the person, you do it for yourself. Because the more stressed you are, the more you carry unforgiveness, you're allowing those negative chemicals being poured into your system. You may actually have had problems. You know, there a lot of studies are out showing there is a negative relationship between unforgiveness and carrying grudges and mental health.
Anayo's back.
So I would say, going back to that number five question, how does it impact you? Yes, it can impact your social life as well. It can impact your spiritual health as well. So it's in your best interest to forgive, even if you just want to do it because of your relationship with the Lord.
But I have a question. I have a friend. She's here. She has a nonchalant attitude. If I'm a mama, she's right there. So for somebody who is nonchalant, which I am too, also I'm guilty of that. That's not, if I have beef with you, you're like forgotten in my life. So I assume that it doesn't affect me. So for people like me, they did nonchalant. So do you think it's affecting us? While like physically, it doesn't look like it's affecting us. And psychologically, emotionally, it doesn't look like it's affecting us.
Well, it depends. Some people do not allow anyone to live in their head without paying rent. And I live that way. But at the same time, I'm not sure, sometimes unconsciously, if you value the relationship that you had with the person, it's always a loss. Mm-hmm.
It is, yeah.
It's always a loss when you lose that relationship. Even if you say, I don't care, you can go to hell, you know.
You do but, care.
I know, because of the time you shared with the person.
They love, you do care. They love the answer.
The lover. I and own
you,
it.
And some of us don't have it.
You have to understand that if we do not practice forgiveness, we wouldn't have a society. We wouldn't have a family. We wouldn't have friendship. We won't be able to function as a society because all of that depends on forgiveness. Think about it. You know, no relationship, no family can survive under the premise that I will never forgive you.
It's true.
Even when you do not want to hurt people, the human nature being what it is, inadvertently you hurt the people that you love, your coworker, your friend, something happens, you break confidentiality. You know, things happen. If we do not practice forgiveness, we will never have a society. We will never have friendship and relationships. You know,
Anayo, can you hear us? Anayo, can you hear us? Anayo, okay. If I'm a mama, go ahead.
Network, you know what?
It's hard. I guess it's horrible.
Holy cow. He's trying to speak.
I am in no worry. Our network is not horrible.
Oh, okay. But
it depends on where you are in the worry and the network you're using.
Exactly. The one Anayo is using is not working.
Wow. I'm going to the next question. Can you hear me? Can you hear me?
Yes.
I'm not in no worry, but the network here is terrible where I am at the moment. I don't know. Keeps dropping.
Please, I think when you ask questions or whatever, to ask other people if they have any input.
Yes.
Before we move on to the next question, is there anything you need to add to the last question? Anything?
Go ahead. We didn't want to do anything. Don't worry, go ahead.
I would like to add something.
The next question is.
Somebody wants to add something, please.
Beep OJ wants to ask something.
Yeah, I wanted to add something. I'm sorry I didn't come in when you started. I was doing something somewhere. So it's possible you may have discussed this aspect on forgiveness. But I think one of the things, errors that we make, and I kept making personally, was, you know, taking forgiveness, although it's a bit rare, not many people have the capacity to do that, is forgive and is not really forget. You will forget, but forgive and favor. That is, you forgive someone, and which is something like what Father referred to as forgiveness and throwing away both wisdom and all that. You forgive someone, you give them back the place they had in your life. I think that is where the issue really gets dicey, because many people know how to just forgive someone, but you never give you that same trust. There are a few people or few of us who you forgive someone because of the way we took the maybe scriptures literally in that for whatever, or the capacity that we have. You forgive someone and you give them back the same place they had in your life. You know, you give them back the same trust, and then they break the trust again. So
why?
When a person does that if several times, I think it then builds up. So I think the area that is also important is the wisdom to know when to draw that line, to know that, yes, you can forgive the first time, forgive several times over, but there comes a time you need to know that this person can't hold that capacity. The person is not capable of keeping this particular level of trust. Mm-hmm. So even while you will forgive them, but you don't give them that same position or favor or whatever, so that you as a person don't get hurt anymore. The second reason is for the sake of your health. It's possible that it's more healthy for you to actually just forgive them, but not give the opportunity for the person to repeat the same error. Perhaps maybe a few times, and then after that, no way. Because that is when it begins to affect your health, because then you will begin to recall, but why did I even let him or her into, you know, to still have the opportunity to do the same thing again and again. And then, so that is where forgiveness can become unhealthy to the person who even forgives. Mm-hmm. When you do it so many times, and the same trust gets broken, then it's like regret, but it's not regret. Maybe a question of thinking back on, why did I even, what was I even thinking that I had to give so many chances? So that is part of what I wanted to contribute. Unforgiveness, yes, it's unhealthy because inside your soul, especially for our spirituality as Igbo people, but also there is a way you forgive someone and then you give them back places that it gets worse, unhealthy for you. So that's my contribution. Sorry if I took a long time.
Thank you.
That was a good contribution.
That's a good one.
Mm-hmm. In terms of health, is very important. Mm-hmm.
And let's, OJ, can we take a comment, because we need to take a 1 minute break again. Do you want to take a comment? Mm-hmm. One comment there.
Okay, yeah, I'm gonna read Nikki Odina's comments. She said, I will always maintain that there is nothing like forget, unless you have amnesia or dementia or biological loss of memory. If you can remember your secondary school experiences, why would you all of a sudden forget an experience? We just learn to move on, that's all. Just as we learn to move on after the loss of a dear one. There is no such thing as forgive and forget.
Okay.
Amen to that. Yeah, man.
Thank you. And let's take a minute break and we'll be right back, please. Okay.
Thank you.
Bear with me.
Hello, everyone. This is Ijoma Wapa Ndoku from Oche Kitchen. I just want to say, Black life matters. All life matters. Make love, not war.
Hi. My name is Winifred Dibwanugu from Oche Kitchen Discussions. I just want to say that Black lives matter. Be you Black, white, brown, we are all one. Let's root out racism so we can make this world a better place. Thank you.
Hi, this is OJ from Oche Kitchen Discussion. I just want to say Black lives matter. All lives matter, actually. Let love lead.
If you remember no job, the Oche Kitchen Discussion reminds you that Black life matters, all life matters, my life matter, your life matters. Love and peace will rule the world. Yes.
Thank you very much. And I'll take my next question. What are the steps in forgiving, and how long does it take to forgive? Father, you want to start?
That's a tough one, because it depends. Forgiveness, you know, I know we're looking at it from the interpersonal relationships, but forgiveness can also happen along the line of me having to forgive myself, you know. So people have different ways. The way I deal with it is, first of all, I am very expressive. I can express the emotion I feel to God. If I am angry at him, I have been moments when things have happened, when life has thrown so much dirt, and I keep asking those universal why me, and I'm angry. I express that emotion to him. Sometimes I have done empty chair exercise. You know, if I'm not able to speak to the individual right away, I will have an empty chair right here in my study, and I will speak to that person and let him have it, you know, make believe that the person is there. Then I can also, when I have experienced catharsis, I have experienced being able to let all of those out, I can ask God for the grace to let go of the anger that I feel and the grace of forgiveness. And then I'll make a decision to let go and move on. So that's how I have, that has been my own personal way of dealing with it.
So thank you.
There is no one way. I look at forgiveness like dealing with loss, you know, like grieving. And sometimes the deeper the love, the longer the period of grief.
Is there a step?
The deeper the love, the deeper the period that you deal with the hurt and the pain, you know, that you feel because the person treated you that way, you know. So it may take a long, and that's why it's important for people who have hurt us not to rush us, you know, not to tell us to flip that switch and start being rosy again and being warm.
Just like Father, just like they will tell you, oh yeah, can you wake you up? What's the end? Okay. Anyone in the audience, do you have anything to add to this, please? Click to here.
Chizo, are you raising your hand? Okay, no.
Okay, and I think I have a bit to add. There are two parts to that question. What are the steps in forgiving? And how long will it take? In the contrary, Father, what you just said, in terms of the length of time, don't force me, because of the way I think and the way I believe, the sooner the better. Why are you taking your time? It's bothering you. And people, in reality, people that take longer to forgive, they're the people that they have, it does have an adverse effect on their lifestyle. Mm-hmm. It's as simple as that. Because for that time you're dragging it on, that's the time you're managing and dealing with that stress.
I hear you, but you have to remember we are wired in a different way.
Exactly.
Every single one of us are wired in a different. Some of us can just boom, you know. That's why even in I use grief to talk about it. Some people, it will take them. Just give you an example. I lost two sisters, elder sisters. Okay, so both of them died in the month of July, and I was actually really. When the first one died, it was 1982. I was just a little boy. And the other one died in 1998, leaving three boys and a girl behind, you know? So every month of July, this has happened for how many years? My mom is 86 now, but every month of July, there is something about her that changes. You know, she's still dealing with it. So you cannot really put, that's the way I look at it. I'm not saying that it should take me that long for me to forgive somebody. No, that's not what I'm saying. But I'm saying you do not have to rush somebody. You know, you just injured me. You just betrayed my trust. And you want me to just flip the light.
So technically, your mom is angry at God too.
Not necessarily.
Just like me and your mom. Me and your mom went
It doesn't have to be angry, but emotions. Remember that the emotion of anger is natural. It's how you express it with, you know,
I have something to say.
Can I say something?
Go ahead. Yeah. Go on. Who's that?
Me?
Okay. Chama, before you go, who goes first? Tumbon, to ask Alaba to tell
Chama Alaba. Can go.
Let me go.
Chama.
Okay. Okay, in as much as we are wired in different ways, I understand that, but I think it's good to encourage people to forgive on time. Just like, I don't know why, I don't always remember our names. Just like she said.
Mama,
thank you so much. I love your own idea, and that's how me I am. For our own sanity, why do you have to take a long time? I'm not saying you have to force somebody to forgive on time or to be like me and you, mama, to forgive immediately to move on. But it's good to encourage. There are some certain things that people normally would not do, but once you encourage them, they'll see themselves doing it, and it's going to benefit them. I don't think I would go and encourage somebody that it takes them 10 years to forgive somebody. Like, yeah, it's okay, it's fine. How about why don't you do it in 3 months? Why don't you try? It's good to encourage somebody, especially for their sanity. Because there are some people, they can't function. If they have unforgiveness, there are somebody they hate somewhere. At work, they become very aggressive at work because it's, you know, their mind is so clouded. They get fired at work. They can't get a business together. They can't even have a good relationship with people. They have high blood pressure. They end up taking drugs from day to day. You know, their relationship with God and human being kind of, you know, it's scattered about. So I think as Christians, we are, because it's in the Bible, forgive our brothers and sisters. God said, if you are coming to give him a sacrifice, go back and settle your problem with anybody you have offended. That's a very good importance on forgiveness. Let's encourage everybody to say, hey, try on time. That's me. I love what mama said, on time. Get it over with. Move on with your life. Have the sanity within yourself and just be happy. And enjoy life.
I can function, though. I can function with Iwe very well. You wouldn't even know. I can comfortably function. Nothing will know her out. You will be forgotten from my life. Next, I think Ego Mama. I think Ego Mama is next.
After Ego, she will go. Yeah. Go on.
Ego, go ahead. Why are you shaking your head? She said, Ego, talk.
I was shaking. Mind yourself, Ijo. Actually, forgiveness is a very difficult thing, but it's actually very easy. But we've had it very difficult because when you come out on earth, the way you start seeing things and see people behave, it influences how you react to things also. So your environment actually affects you. And I thought forgiveness was very difficult, honestly, but by the time I started developing myself and learning about forgiveness, I now understood that at times, as somebody is even hurting you, you might get to that state that you're even forgiving before the person realizes what he or she is doing to you. Why am I saying that? If you look at what people do to you with empathy, you tend to see whatever they are doing differently, you know, because you have a deeper understanding. Somebody might be hurting you. Looking at it, you might think, oh, why is this person doing this to me? Is she not thinking right? But at times, most people are so screwed. So most people are ill. Most people have, their mind is not even, they are not okay. So they are not doing that intentionally. They're not even in control of their action. So at times, when you actually empathize with people, you find out that it's easier for you to forgive. Even when it comes to marriages, with my experience, I know a lot of people like say, wow, why did you go through this? Why are you not talking about this? Why are you not bearing grudge against your ex? But there are things I've come to understand that he wasn't even in control, or he was misinformed. And most people have psychological problems, so they do things without even knowing they are doing it. So if you can understand why somebody is doing something, it helps you, it makes it easier for you to forgive that person and probably help the person.
You know, this is where intent comes in. If I know you intentionally hurt me, forget about me. But if I know, like, it's, you know what I mean? Like, you wake up 100 times. If I know there was no intent, I don't have a, I'm a very nonchalant person. Nothing bothers me. But if I know you have intent.
Delete. Intent is, let me tell you, intent, some people are not well. Some people, their minds are screwed.
Then it's a psych thing.
That's what I'm saying. Exactly. That's what I'm saying. You empathize with the person more. Because the person, honestly, if it's a proper person doing the right thing, doing the right thing, probably they wouldn't have done that. Okay. It's not easy to forgive, but the thing is that you can actually grow yourself spiritually. And it's possible, because if it wasn't possible, our Lord Jesus Christ, as our Lord, told us to practice it. It's just that you just have to bring yourself to that level.
That's a very valid point of what you've just said. They someone being in control of themselves when they commit. Chi, do you want to go?
Hello, good evening,
she
sisters.
I just said what I wanted to.
That's all.
Which Chi are you talking about? Is it Chizo or Chi?
Chi,
go ahead. Chizo, give us a minute, okay?
Not Chizo.
Chi, go ahead.
Chizo, I'll come to you in a minute.
Yeah, I said.
I'll come to
you. Sego Mama has already said what I wanted to say.
Okay.
I'd like to say two ways, mm-hmm. In the sense that not only is it is a conscious process, it's intentional, it's something that you'd make a decision to do, but at the same time, it's a two-way street. It's not a one-way street. You cannot forgive someone who doesn't want to be forgiven.
Exactly.
This is in relation to interpersonal relationships. Mm-hmm. You cannot enforce your forgiving spirit onto someone who doesn't think that they are deserving of the forgiveness you accord them. So where does that leave us? You know, what kind of situation do we find ourselves in? Do we redefine situations or dynamics in relationships because this forgiveness borders on doing the right thing as Christians, and as well as for your own peace of mind. But that's not all that there is to forgiveness. Forgiveness has to be something that is a thought out process that someone would have to do when they think that they are willing to understand.
Oh, Jesus, is that your baby?
Yeah, that's all right.
Oh, I was looking for you to. I was looking for who to mute. Sorry.
Okay, sorry about that.
No, guys.
Of all the times.
No, go ahead. I thought it was somebody else. Go ahead. Yeah.
Nah. Of all the times. Sorry. Of all the times to mess up, this is it. But this is a two-way street in the sense that.
Forgiveness
has got to be.
Can you check your phone? Check your phone.
Yeah, forgiveness is something that is a give and take because you cannot enforce your forgiveness upon someone else, because we're all made up differently, we all think things differently, we all have our psychological makeup due to our how we're born, how our brains are wired, and how and our and our lived experiences on a day-to-day basis. So that would form, I suppose, the crux about how quickly we forgive, how we're willing to forgive, and how the forgiveness, the impact of the forgiveness on our lives. That's all I say.
How
do you manage that in interpersonal relationships? Because I find that's probably one of the hardest things to do, because everyone comes from different upbringing, background, life experiences, and expectations of people. I suppose in a way they define how we're able to relate to one another and how we're able to move things forward.
Can I say something? Our time is up, but the father is willing to stay. Are you guys willing to stay over time?
I'm willing to stay.
Should we continue?
Yeah.
Is everybody okay with that?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
I'm just gonna
Ijam, I wanted to say something. I think it's an interesting topic. Just that my question has propped so many people. I've got people who want to add one or two things. Can we start with Martha? Is Martha still here?
Yes. Sorry, please. What is the question?
Yeah, she's here.
Please, what is the question? I'm sorry, I'm late.
She wanted to ask a question. I want to add something.
You want to ask?
Max, go ahead. Max, go ahead. Yeah.
Hello.
Go ahead. We can hear you.
I wanted to contribute. So if that opening is there, then I could just make.
Yeah, go on. Go ahead.
Okay. Hi, guys. Nice seeing you all. I just want to highlight, I mean, this is a very interesting topic, and you can't see me.
Uh-huh. We can hear her.
That's okay, go ahead. We can hear you.
I'm tying my hair like the Oche Kitchen stuff, so.
That's okay, we appreciate you.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so I just want to highlight on what I would say I'd worked for a very close friend of mine. And I kind of took that as a lesson for my own self, and I would like to share that. So just to cut the story short, he's one of my best friends. I never used to, he's a Yoruba guy, so, and a colleague. And the guy had sat a few years back, discovered that his father was not actually, the person that raised him was not his biological father. And that was like when he was almost 40 years, and it was when they went for the burial. So to cut the story short, we went for the burial because he is my colleague and a very good friend of mine. So we got there and they finished buried the guy, and we were just trying to, you know, as in them, we're trying to put sand into the grave, you know, the traditional way. And from nowhere, three guys just came. Three guys, as in these guys, then were like averagely 32 or 35 years old. Three of the guys. They just packed their car, went straight to the grave, picked sand, and the villagers were just holding them. No, you won't drop sand into here and all that. And the elders had to gather them, took them in, had a quick discussion, and elders had to allow those three guys to come out and pour sand into the grave. Meanwhile, when all those things were going on, the wife of this man that we came to bury was seated somewhere, you know, the traditional way. They just sit somewhere, as in the wives and all that. Then, immediately, the elders now called the sons of the guy, which includes this, my very good friend. And they now told them that, these three guys that came were this guy's sons. And this, my very good friend, his father had always been a regular guy. When we talk of regular guy, comes back, take them through homework, teach them, always at home. Cut the story short, by the time the mother discovered that this guy had an affair for almost 4 years outside his marital wherever with three big boys, the woman could not hold it. She stood up there. This is not a movie. I saw my eyes. She stood up, went to the grave of this guy, her husband, and she started cursing him. She started crying. She started cursing, and she started telling him. She said, 40 years I was married to you. You hid this secret. You died with this secret. You did this. She was crying and cursing. So where am I coming from? I just want to cut the story short. You know, when we talk of forgiveness, it is not, number one, it's not an easy thing. I just try to remember this woman. I try to remember this woman. 40 years of marriage with this man, regular man. They have 5 kids. Life, 40 years of marriage. And during burial, this woman, the guy died with the secret, just to crown it all. So the guy died with the secret of not letting this first wife know what happened. And this woman, it was in his burial that the guy discovered, the wife discovered what really happened. So forgiveness is hard. We can, it is easy with God, but it is hard. Trust me. I don't know about this other woman, but I don't know if she will deal with this forgiveness for, like, if she will even die with it. But where am I coming from personally?
Okay.
When I talk this with my friend, this is my friend that this thing happened to them. I'm not like, number one, I said, Lee, you discovered that one, finally, he now discovered that the guy himself, anyways, another story, you know, let me not go into that. But anytime anyway, I talk with this guy, he always Martha, advance forgiveness. This is one statement he always use. He'll say, advance forgiveness. There's this thing I call advance forgiveness. Advance forgiveness. And I said, you and this advance forgiveness. And by the time I noticed that is his nature, he's like, before anybody will do you something, that's what he told me. Before anybody will do you something, just understand that they are imperfect. So they are definitely going to wrong you. So by the time that heart will start building, just have advanced forgiveness for your own sake, for your own health. You get what I mean? So it's number one, it is not easy to forgive. I've heard all of us talk about intent, unintentional, and yes, when it comes to unintentional, that one is understandable. The person might have done something that you feel is hurting to you, but the person didn't even know. But when it's like this person knows what he's doing, and you, that is the person to forgive, you see this person repeating this. It is a pattern, my dear. You just need to give your own self advanced forgiveness and then forget. So let's not mix to forget and to forgive, because there's a thin line between these two things, to forget and to forgive. So for me, my advice is everybody should just, if you can, just build up that advanced forgiveness and tell yourself, whether
I wish
this
advanced forgiveness is paper. If I'm gonna give me advanced forgiveness now,
I have some.
Can I make one contribution?
Hold on. Ify Ferguson, is she still here? She wanted to add something.
She's here.
Ify, can you add something?
I'm trying to unmute her. If I'm gonna unmute yourself, she's okay.
All right, I had to go incognito because I'm in the kitchen. But what a lot of you have said, good evening, good afternoon, or wherever you may be, good discussion. And as far as forgiveness goes, I think it has to come from a personal perception, because Ifoma and Ijoma, they're very free-spirited people. So what they may call nothing could be a huge burden for another person. What they may hold you unaccountable for, another person may hold you accountable for that. And that's where the grudge system begins. So as far as healing time, I tend to get towards what the Reverend Father said, because it all depends on what you hold against somebody to begin to. I mean, as much as it's really nice to free yourself, but it depends on how badly, like we talk about intentional or unintentional. You know, for somebody that you think that somebody, you know, presumed something, planned it out and hurt you, went out completely to hurt you. It might be more
exactly my point
for you to forgive that person, as much as it may be a burden to you. Because the healing, forgiveness is just like the mourning. You know, you can go through different stages of grief so that I'm able to grieve and get over a debt in a few weeks. Another person could be grieving for years.
Yes.
So that's how forgiveness is. So I think spirituality does help, because you need a lot of grace for you to come to terms to say, this thing, it hurts so badly, but despite my human nature, I want to take the nature of Christ to let it go, because it's letting go, and then you start healing. So I think it's based on personal perception, because if I take, like, I have a child that is a special needs child. This is one person that I feel like if you hurt anything or you say anything to hurt this child, even in a bit of anger, I might find it a longer time to forgive you, because I think you've really stabbed me in the heart. Because for me, I see her as a blessing. You might not see, because you might think you said it in the heat of the moment, but for me, that is the worst. I'd rather have you stab me than say anything about this child. Because it's bad enough you have a child you have to do extra for, but for somebody to throw it at you like it's your fault, it takes it to a different level. And so telling me to forgive it, it's just a spur of the moment speech, might be more difficult for me. So I think it's a perception of where that hurt is coming
from.
Exactly. You know, it has to be where you're hurting from. That's what sets the motion for forgiveness. So yes, it's very easy, but it's very difficult to achieve. Thank you.
Thank you.
Can I add something? Yeah. I want to say, because that question says, what are the steps? So I think if I want to articulate at least one or two or three steps, the first step is actually a conscious, deliberate decision by the person who wants to forgive. You have to decide that you want to forgive that person. It has to be conscious. It has to be deliberate, because if you don't take that decision, then the matter hasn't even started. That's one. Number two, you also have to now decide whether you are forgiven because the person is repentant, is remorseful, or you are going to forgive all the same, whether they are repentant or remorseful or not. Now, the first wing, where they are actually repentant and remorseful, is easier. But then if the people are not repentant or remorseful about what they've done, that is what some of you referred to as if a person wants to be forgiven. I think at that point, it's no longer, to me, it's not whether the person wants to be forgiven or not. It's based on whether I want to do away with the whole stuff, the whole toxin. So you can forgive that person and forget it, you know, but you don't have to, you know, because if the person doesn't want to be forgiven, then the person doesn't even want to relate. So they're carrying on in what they have done. And we find this common among, I don't know if it's the whole Nigeria, but Igbo men, and a number of them don't know how to apologize or be remorseful about what they've done wrong. It's like, why did you even find out that I did wrong?
Amen.
That is where they, you know, you do something wrong, you discover and you find out they've done wrong. Hello? Eh?
I'm sorry. I'm minority here.
Yes, they're minority here, but you find it is very common among the Nigerian men. Instead of them to actually be remorseful about what they've done wrong, is like, how? Why did you even find out? They want to like,
huh?
So
they will turn
but
it around.
It's up to you.
They will turn it around, and
yes,
you will not be apologizing.
Exactly.
Yes.
They will start covering up. That is now your sin. It's no longer na Ihemedu hojo sibiko gbara. So it is the third step is for you to now decide that, okay, I'm going to let it go, no matter, even though they are not remorseful. But then you now determine where you keep that person in your trust hierarchy. That is my own submission. Thank you.
Thank you.
That was a good step. Thank you.
Benson is an exception. Okay.
Who, Benson?
He said he can apologize to whomever. So that he's an exception to that rule, that we can generalize and paint all of us with the same brush. So
if I'm on your mute, Benson is like OJ, but
there was something Benson said in our previous shows. And I've not forgot about it. Yes, forgiveness is foolishness.
Don't mind Benson.
I love that. Enjoy. Moving on.
Mm? Let me say something. I've been listening to all of you.
Okay.
And I wanted to make one or two comments.
Go on.
From
to the show.
Thank you. Even what you guys are saying is quite understandable, but what I want to share with people is, forgiveness and forgetfulness and all those things, anger and the rest of it. You have to understand that whatever is onya pasumi where I got so mad, why should I forgive? Why should I forget? The point is, whether you forgive or you forget, life must always continue, one. Two, what causes people to get so angry that they don't forgive? It's because we have too much attachment to material things, or too much clinging to things. I'll give you an example.
Too much trust.
Mm-hmm. You cling too much to people, and when you cling too much, that is when they disappoint you, and that is when you start looking for forgiveness and forgetfulness. Amen. But when you don't cling too much,
thank you, Victor.
Let's say you have a child. Oh, my daughter, my son, I need to have this done. I need this done. You are clinging too much. The attachment is too much, but you have forgotten that that person has his or her own life.
Amen.
So when they do something that is contrary to what you believe,
get hurt.
That is when you start getting what? Hurt. And that is when you start getting angry. And what I always tell people about anger is very simple. Anger is like drinking poison, expecting the other person to what? Die.
Die.
But it is you who has swallowed the poison that is going to die. Mm-hmm. Therefore, when you reduce your attachment to husband, to wife, brother, sister, friend,
less expectation,
you have really nothing to be angry about. When you talk about relationship between husband and wife, for example, first question you ask yourself, what got you into that relationship? You have agenda. The man probably has agenda. And that agenda, it is only you who knows it. And it is only him who knows it. Like the one that said the wife or the husband cheated on the wife. If that wife would be honest to herself, she will not tell you when you ask her, Nne, what happened? She will say, I've been a good wife. I've done this. I've done that. But the real problem, she knows it. And the husband knows it. But she will never tell you that thing. Therefore, the person you have to be most afraid of is who? Yourself. Because it is only you who knows the truth. And it is only you who knows how to solve the problem. And when people extend anger and fear and unforgiveness, it's because they are expecting other people around to solve the problem for them. So when you go to courthouse, for example, you're getting a divorce, you are now narrating your household problem to a judge who doesn't know you. So what do you expect the judge to do? Your husband will come, he'll tell his own story. You will come, you'll tell your own story. And you're expecting a stranger to be the God that has been overseeing two of you. It's not possible. It is who tells the better story that gets the better reward. So emotions are scared because we cling too much. And that is why we are looking for how long does it take to forgive? How long does it take us not to be angry? The anger dissipates the moment you're honest to yourself. And you do what? You thank God that you're even alive and you move on.
Thank you.
It's just like the one that the father said about death. I always tell people, as long as you are born, we must all do what? We must all die. Why are we so afraid of dying? We are so afraid of dying because there are certain things within us that we think we are supposed to have done that we did not do. Therefore, when time catches up with you, you do what? You panic. So the truth lies within us. Forgiveness is when you forgive yourself, you'll be able to forgive any other person. So when somebody hurts you, don't worry too much. What you have to worry is, how do you detach yourself, uncling yourself to that relationship. It is an honor to have a relationship with people because we are humans, we are social beings. But don't attach too much so that you don't get disappointed. So that's what I wanted to share with you guys. So we have to learn to forgive ourselves first.
Thank you.
Once we forgive ourselves, then to forgive somebody else is quite easy. If you don't forgive yourself, you cannot forgive somebody else. And remember, the things that why people fight is because your own method is not corresponding with the other person's method. Therefore, it's whose method will prevail.
Mm-hmm.
So when the other person's method prevails against yours, you live a life of perpetual anger. But in every game, there is a winner and there must be a loser. It takes pain to understand peace. If you don't have pain, you won't understand what peace looks like. So we have to start with our inner self first. When you start with your inner self, love yourselves very well. I mean, there is really not much to forgive and forget. If you like, you carry grudge. You carry the grudge and do what? Go in your grave.
Mm.
And the moment they cover your graveyard, life will continue immediately. It will not stop. So that's my contribution.
Thank you very much, Chiki.
Okay.
Thank you so much. We have really, really gone very far. And we still have so many questions to ask. Father, I don't know if you've been there before. Father, can we have you again next week?
Father can stay till 5:30. He can stay till 5:30 today. Yeah.
So we still have the time.
We have 9 minutes.
You only have nine minutes.
9 minutes. So if I forgot, I have to question.
Leave by 5:30.
Father, we appreciate you. Thank you.
Well, thank you. So we'll take, I think this will only, we'll only have one question. Audience, we'll have to come back next week. We have lots to talk about forgiveness. It's a very juicy topic and really need to trash it out. So the next question is, how do you know if you've been forgiven? How do you know if you have forgiven someone, rather? So there are two parts to it, and we could take it from any side,
Well, often, it depends. If you're asking how do I know if I have forgiven someone, there are two ways that I measure whether I have forgiven. One, it's by what I say and also by what I do. And the reason I do that is because my standard for measuring whether I've been forgiven or I have forgiven someone is, as a Christian, as a Catholic, and as a priest, I go by what Jesus would, I use him as the standard. So how did he forgive us? He forgave by words and by action. On the cross, he showed that he has forgiven. And he also promised that the Bible says that if you confess your sins, that our God will cleanse us of all our unrighteousness, 1 John. So I believe that. So when I personally, it's not just, I always like what I say to match what I do. If I have forgiven people, that means that I have to gauge how do I bear grudges against that person? Do I have resentment towards this person? You know, do I wish them evil? You know, how is my feelings towards them? So I know from my words and actions, and when I no longer resent them, when I no longer begrudge them, I know that at least I have released all of those negative emotions and negative energies. But I may not, you know, allow them to enjoy a state of trust again in that relationship. They have to earn it. Behavior has consequences. Forgiving someone does not mean that they don't pay a price for what they did. You know, behavior has consequences. Otherwise, none of us should work towards repentance at all. If God has forgiven us and desires everybody to be saved and he has forgiven everyone, then why worry? You know, why plead for forgiveness when he has automatically given it to everybody? You know, so behavior has consequences. If people offend me, if they hurt me in a manner they are not supposed to treat someone they love, I create boundaries. You have to earn it to tell me that you have turned a new leaf for me to put you in the same place. On my own side, I have to gauge, how do I feel towards them? Do I still bear grudges? Do I, resent them? Do I wish them evil, So if those feelings are no longer there, I know that I have made progress towards forgiving them.
Father, sorry, this is Matt. I have a question to what you just said.
Yes.
A little question, just so that I don't miss it out. From what you just said, if someone says, if you have forgiven someone and the person peradventure just maybe misbehave based on what you've forgiven the person, and you that have forgiven, you find yourself saying, oh, I repeat, like, I forgive you last time, now you're repeating the same thing now. I'll find it difficult to forgive you again. Is that a complete forgiveness?
No, that is not what I mean. You got me wrong. Remember the Bible.
I'm not saying is what you said. I'm asking a question based on what you just explained in terms of it's just a question that just cropped.
Martha is going to be in the next question. So Father can answer it, because that's the question Ifeoma is going to ask.
That's why I treat that.
Ifeoma, go ahead. Mama.
Ifeoma is muted, and anybody else can.
Okay, the next question. Ifeoma, ask your next question. Go ahead.
What about?
Ifeoma, we have
the next question. Actually, I know. I'm very conscious of time here. We've had a poll on our page. Please, you can still visit our page Oche_Kitchen on Facebook and give us your answers on this poll. The poll is on this question now. How do I forgive someone who does not recognize they helped me or who is not sorry? Funny enough, 88% said yes, they can forgive.
And I
4% said no, they wouldn't. Father,
I can understand that, because you want to hope that somebody who hurt you, who has not apologized, and who is not sorry and doesn't recognize it, you want to hope that there is something lacking in them that made them treat you the way they treated you. You want to hope that thing lacking maybe there is a mental illness, maybe there is pressure, maybe there is ignorance, maybe there is something that that impacted their judgment when they did what they did, okay? So you want to hope that there is something lacking in them. And if something is lacking in them that makes them not culpable for actually treating you the way they have treated you, which is possible. People can, like many of you have mentioned here, that somebody may not have, may not be rational, may have mental illness, may not have full knowledge, may not have the intent, and they may treat you in that way, okay? That's what you want to hope. And if something like that happened, I will be able to let go, because there is something going on here, something deeper that this individual has no control over. So these things made the person not responsible for the action. Think about it, even in a law court, when somebody did something, a heinous crime, even the jury, the judge, before they give, they pass sentence on the person, they look into the mental, what was the person thinking when they did that? Did they have full knowledge? Was their faculty intact when they did that? And that can mitigate the sentence that is being given to the person. In the same way in our interpersonal relationship, yes, someone can hurt you, or hurt me, not recognize it, not be sorry because they're incapable of recognizing it because of something that has happened to them.
I want to add to that. I think it may not just be because based on those analytical reasonings about there may be something wrong. I think majority of our people, based on our religious beliefs, would want to incline to, oh, let us forgive because God said, or Bible said, that we should forgive. That is perhaps why a good chunk of people want to forgive even when the person has not been remorseful. And then another thing, another reason is because people still want to, you know, they still value whatever relationship they have with that person. So those are two other reasons that would lead to that high vote, you know. Those are my thoughts.
And sometimes, like I said before, in Luke's gospel, I believe Luke chapter 17 from verse 3 to 4, if your brother sins, rebuke him. If he repents, forgive him. If he repents, he doesn't say regardless of whether they are sorry or not. And I say that again, because I said it before, that if someone, you know, consciously does something wrong to me and doesn't recognize it and is bold in it, I don't have a Christian obligation to forgive them. I may forgive them, but I do not have the obligation to do so. It doesn't mean I cannot, but I'm saying putting a should there doesn't go.
Can I make a contribution?
Yes.
Can I add to what the priest is saying? Hello, everyone.
Hi.
Stella, hello, go on, yeah. Stella, we can hear you.
Yeah, hello everyone. And I just want to add to what the priest is saying. Thank you so much. I just want to add to what the priest is saying. And there are some people that are, that's the way they behave, that's their way they live. And they can hurt you, or consciously, they won't know that they've hurted you. There are some people that don't even know they've hurted you. And I think to me, what I think, because I would just have to ask, this is what you've done to me, I'm not really happy with this. Some people assume that they're okay because that's their personality, that's how they live. They don't see anything wrong in what they've said or what they've done because that is how they live. So it's up to you.
Like Ijama, my friend.
And like Ifoma, my friend as well, you know. So you know, so that's what I'm saying. So sometimes you would
help me every day.
Some people do something unconscious without knowing that they've hurted you. So it's just something that you have to bring to their attention and let them know. If they want to say sorry, they want to own up to that, they say sorry to you. Some they know and they just carry their face on, and that's, you take it from there. So my own personal view is that there are some that can hurt you and unconsciously they don't know they've done that. It's just for you to approach and say, yo, this is what you've done, or boy, man, or husband. Even my husband does that sometimes. And he'll think, oh, it's cool with it. And I say, guy, I give him my face. I say, I'm not happy with this thing you've done. And he'll recognize that. So I'm sorry, I didn't know I've done something wrong. You know, so you just need to learn how to forgive. And somebody, you just get angry or thinking, having sleep last night, the other person not knowing that he or she have done something wrong to you. You know,
right.
Thank you.
It's time, the father is about to leave us. So okay. Sorry, everybody, we'll come back next week for part two. So Ifeoma, can you round up?
Sisters and brothers, I want to thank you, but I have to go. I have another.
Thank you so much. So thank you, Father. We appreciate you.
Amen. 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 Thank you very much.
Thank you. I have something to say. Thanks, Father. Can I say something? There's a comment. Can you hear me? It says, people come into your life for a reason, purpose of time. Only you and God can be in your life for a lifetime, okay? Everybody else, family, spouse, children, siblings, friends, and strangers are in your life for a reason, purpose or both. Thank you very much, everyone. It's been a brilliant evening. Please, we're back again next week, Saturday, 9 p.m. to continue on this topic. There's so much to be talked about, and we aim that everybody must pick out one thing. That's why we're sharing ideas. Thank you very much, and stay put while we enjoy a bit of our music.
All right, Father, thank you. Bye.
Thank you. Yeah. All right. Bye-bye. Thanks.
If I'm a hit us with the music.
Hit us with the music.
So, one here.
Yeah,
forgiveness music. Is it forgiveness music?
We played forgiveness coming in, but Ifeoma likes to live with a bag. She likes to, you know, live with a bag. We came in with forgiveness music, Tracy Chapman, yeah. I'm sorry.
Okay.
It's all
there you can say.
Ijoma, I forgive you.
Exactly.
Ijoma, I forgive you.
Bam,
bam. I will never forgive you. I will never forgive you.
It still feels like a first night together.
Bye, everyone.
Bye, thank you.
Bye.
Bye. Bye. Bye.